Hey, welcome to my channel. I'm Shelly, and I made a previous video on making wet specimens, and I gave you a glimpse into our science cabinet. But today is the day I'm gonna show you everything in my science cabinet because it's full of really cool stuff, but I also had the suggestion from Carl Homer Mendoza. So big shout out to you. Thanks for the suggestion. Here's the video, and I'm gonna show you everything we've got because it's super cool. The first thing I want to show you is this cool skull. I have had several experts look at it. We haven't been able to determine exactly what it is, so we found it in our backyard. It was in the forest, way back in the forest in our backyard. And I know there's a lot of possibilities of what it could be, but the consensus is it's a bear or a coyote. And I even took it to the Department of Natural Resources and to some camp counselors and conservationists. They couldn't quite tell exactly. I didn't give it to them. I gave them pictures. That's probably, if I had brought it to them, they probably would have figured it out. But anyway, this is a bear or a coyote. Thought that was really cool. One of my favorite pieces in this cabinet is my fossilized megalodon tooth. Now it's cracked in half. It used to be like this, but I bought it like this. I got it at South Carolina in Charleston at Patriots Point. And apparently South Carolina coasts are famous for having a lot of megalodon teeth and fossils and stuff. So I had a lot of them. So this is one of my favorites. I've always loved sea creatures and sharks. And let's be honest, megalodon is kind of the king of kings when it comes to that. So I love, love, love this tooth. I also have a cool meteorite fragment, a real one. Now, if you've seen my video on making a bug collection in resin, that's where my kids and I made these. And we went through our forest and trudged around and found a bunch of bugs. And these are best beetles. They're pretty cool. And in the cabinet, though, it's all black and the beetles were black. So you couldn't see them. So I put a white piece of paper behind it so you could actually see them. But anyway, they're really cool and they barely fit in the mold. It was really cool to make these bugs out of resin. And I've got a few more back here. We also keep honeybees here. We have several hives out in the back, and we were able to collect two little honeybees and a queen cell. Now the queen cell is made out of honeycomb and or wax, I should say, the wax that holds all the honey. And this is where the queens are raised and where they hatch and emerge. So we wanted to save that. We found and collected a couple more beetles. I don't remember what they're called. They're really common, but they made a good addition to the collection. We also collected some beeswax from our hives. The bees were making this where they weren't supposed to, so I had to cut it out of the hive. And it's really neat and, of course, waxy to touch. If you notice all the little hexagons, bees don't actually make the hexagons. What they do is they make circles out of the wax, and then as they pull all the circles together, it makes a hexagon. Nifty tidbit. Here's something you might see in the forest if you live in the south like us. It's the skin of a katydid. I'm gonna try to make it so you can see. Pretty cool, super fragile though, so I try to be careful with it. There we go. Here's something my dog found out in the yard. It is a snake skin. She was barking at it like it was a wild animal, but it was just a skin. It's almost impossible to tell the breed of snake based on a shed skin, but we do have a lot of rat snakes out here. We have a lot of eastern king snakes. We do have a lot of poisonous snakes. We have timber rattles, cottonmouths, and copperheads. However, we live a little too far away from the water to worry about cottonmouths, but we do have to worry about copperheads and rattlesnakes. So it's always nice to have non-venomous snakes around to keep the venomous ones away. I don't know how that works, but they are amazing. So we like keeping our rat snakes and our king snakes around for protection. Here's a little piece of a jaw with some teeth that we found out in the yard. Another couple of things we got in Charleston, South Carolina was this beautiful sand dollar. Sorry if it's really bright in here for this white piece of shell. And this sea biscuit. I thought these were really cute. They look like a real biscuit. Really cute. Ah. Of course, I've got a starfish and we got some pretty shells. You might be wondering what this is. No, it was never a living thing. This is just blown glass. It looks like a jellyfish. And I love it. I got it at the Smithsonian Museum. But you can find them in a lot of glass blowing shops. They're really gorgeous. Mine actually glows in the dark, which makes it even better. And now to my wet specimens. You've seen many of these in the video where I show you how I made these wet specimens called Making Wet Specimens. This is our mouse. But I also have a new one that I'm really, really excited about. My cat caught this mouse, so I was very grateful. I had to thank my cat. Here's one of my favorites. This big fluffy rat was found in our storage shed. It was already dead, but it was obviously really freshly dead, so I have no idea how it died. But my daughters found it, and as soon as we got it all preserved and in the liquid, it puffed up like a stuffed animal, and it looks positively adorable. I think we named it, but I don't remember what its name is. But anyway, super fluffy, super cute. Here's my rat. Here's my baby octopus. I got this at a fish market, actually, so I didn't catch it, definitely didn't catch it. But they cleaned it out like a fish, and so I had to go get my suturing set and practice for the first time suturing up an animal. So I had to suture like his head to the rest of his body. It worked out really well, so. Here's my mole. My dog dug this up, and it was also part of my Making Wet Specimens video. He's also very fluffy, super cute. And now for our new wet specimens addition. I love this guy. His name is Marcus the Sharkus. He originally came from a university lab, but I guess they were downsizing, letting go of some things, and now his home is here with me, and I love him, and he's so adorable. So I freshened up his liquid, his isopropyl alcohol, but he's still a little yellow, so I need to freshen it up once again. But anyway, he has his new happy home here. If you're interested in making wet specimens like we did, I highly recommend you check out my video called Making Wet Specimens. It's really helpful and it's a really neat process. I highly recommend it to anybody who is a budding scientist or has a love of life and biology. And if you're wondering where you find a dead animal to preserve, I was actually told that once you start looking for dead animals, you'd be surprised how many you find. And that was so true. I don't normally stumble upon dead animals. But believe me, as soon as I started looking for them because I wanted to do this project, I started to find quite a few. I get comments all the time on people that have their pets that have passed away and wanted to find a way how to preserve them. Just about everything from a mouse, a gerbil, cockroach, I think is quite a few animals that were requested. So make sure to check out that video. It is such a neat process and I highly recommend this for anyone who wants a cool science collection at home. We're now gonna go to the bottom level and I'm gonna show you a few more things. This is a nest that we found. We didn't pull it out of a tree. The limbs were actually all being cut down and we were cleaning up all the branches and giving them to our goats so they could eat the leaves. But we found this inside and we thought it was so beautiful and intricate. There were no eggs or anything like that. Nobody was living in it at the time, but it's just so beautiful. So we put it in a dog dish. I also keep some petri dishes. So anytime we want to test some bacteria or test dirty surfaces, we can, including our dog's mouth. The first time we used these, I actually tried making my own penicillin. I really tried doing my research. I really worked hard. It didn't work out, but next time, hopefully it will. I used these petri dishes to actually grow the bacteria to test it on. This isn't where I tried to growing the penicillin. This is where I tried growing the bacteria and then testing the penicillin on, I believe gram positive bacteria is the word for it. Anyway, it didn't work, but maybe next time. Another favorite in here is our test tubes. One of my daughters loves making cool little concoctions and putting them in here, especially with food coloring. But we've also used it to extract actual DNA, both from ourselves and I think strawberries. You can learn how to do that. I would love to do a video on that. So if anybody's interested in extracting DNA so you can actually visually see strands, you can't actually see the strands of DNA because they're so small, but they clump up so tightly together that you can see the clumps of DNA. So maybe I'll do a video if anyone's interested on how to extract DNA from either yourself or from fruit. These posts are for after washing the tubes, you can turn them over and put them on. If anyone's interested in something like this, I've got a link in my description where you can find them on Amazon. Now this over here is not very scientific, I don't know, more like history. I also got this at Patriots Point in Charleston, South Carolina. It's a grenade, a real grenade, but obviously it's hollowed out, made safe, completely safe, but it's still a real grenade, which I thought was really cool. So we like keeping this in our collection. Something I would recommend for any scientist at heart to keep around the house are these and these. So these you can get at Walmart. They're really cheap. I think it was like $1.97 for two. Sorry if the light is a little bright for them. But they are these little test tubes, glass test tubes, rubber stub. Anyway, this way you can pick up just about anything and move things around small, especially for microscopes. They are really, really, really handy for microscopes that you can move things around. And these I use together. I actually got these at Dollar Tree. So Dollar Tree has a bunch of these. They're in the Tupperware section for food, for snacks. But they come with lids and they're a dollar for like 10. So you get like a ton of them. We used them heavily when we were looking for tardigrades or water bears, those little cool microscopic little piggies. So anyway, these are at Dollar Tree, super helpful, come with lids too. And then these at Walmart, they're like a dollar each. One of my favorite tools is this observation microscope. I used it in the video on finding water bears, how to find tardigrades. I made a video on it, check it out. Link is in the description, but this observation microscope made all the difference. So if you're wondering what the difference is between an observation microscope and a compound microscope, here they are. So this is a compound microscope and it can view things much, much, much smaller. So it has the different settings. Let's see, 4x, 40x, and 10x on here. So this can see really, really tiny things. This does not zoom in that far, so you can get a really good view of really small things, but not necessarily microscopic. And so this gave us the ability to find the tardigrades, and then this gave us the ability to take a really close look at them. So if you are looking for water bears, want to have some fun looking for those cute little piggies, make sure to have an observation microscope, because if you just have this, it's going to take you a million years to track through all the different water and moss that you have to find, because it views things so small. So use this, and this one actually hooks up. It doesn't have a viewer, it hooks up to my computer so I can see on full screen what I'm looking at on here. And it even takes pictures and records. I tried taking pictures and video of our tardigrades on this by balancing my phone up here. And oh my goodness, it was a nightmare. I got some good shots, kind of, but it was pretty bad. So if you ever have the opportunity to get a microscope that hooks up to your phone or your computer, I highly recommend it. And if you're looking for something like this, the link is in the description. This belongs to my mother-in-law. I have no idea where she got it, and I have no idea how old it is. It's fantastic, but I'm sorry I can't give you a reference of where to find them. But I know Amazon does have a lot of great compound microscopes that you can find like this. My kid's last microscope is this cool beginner's microscope. I highly recommend this for any kids who are scientists at heart that want a beginner jump start. It even has little slides that are pre-prepared for you, so you can look at things like a plant cell and take a look at those cool things. It's got a lot of them. So it's really fun, really great for beginners. And this is also on Amazon if anyone's interested, but it was really helpful for my kids. I've got two more things in this cabinet, but they're actually up top. First thing is, it's just a jar with moss. I went out to my forest and I got some moss because I wanted to make like my own little ecosystem in here. And so I just put some moss in and I added some water. So it actually vaporizes and kind of condenses and falls and waters itself over and over again. So every now and then I'll open the lid to let in some more fresh oxygen. But for the most part, it's kind of its own little self-contained ecosystem. And I never checked this moss for tardigrades, but I'll bet you there's some in there. This cool thing is called a Marimo moss ball. My daughter was actually given this for her birthday by a friend, and it's the coolest thing ever. So these are really easy to find and really inexpensive. You can get them at just about any pet store, and it's a moss ball, but it's actually a ball of algae. It's called a Marimo moss ball, but it's actually just algae. And it just kind of floats around, and it's a ball. It's supposed to be a perfectly round ball, but I was cleaning the tank and I was cleaning the ball out last week, and I was a little too rough and it kind of broke in the middle. So I apologize, but normally it's really fluffy and it's perfectly round and it just kind of rolls around, and you're supposed to shake the jar to help it move around and keep that round shape. They're really, really cool. I really love it. You can actually get them for fish. It's like a toy for fish, which I thought was really cool. Anyway, Marimo moss ball. Got some rock salt. These were a few really cool little fossils that came with like a fossil digging kit that my daughter really loved. I made sure to give our cabinet an extra cool factor with our LED lights on the front and the sides. It's color changing, so I change it to whatever color I want. And that's it. That is our science collection at home, but I really want to know what's in your home. If you have a science collection, please let me know what's in it because I'm really, really curious. Just put it in the comments. I'm definitely gonna read it and get right back to you because I'm super curious. And if you liked what was in our science collection, please let me know. Give this video a huge thumbs up and let me know in the comments. And don't forget to subscribe. I'm Shelly, the Little Black Shade Tree.